Morning, everybody.
Morning.
Lovely sunny day at the minute. And that's all I'm going to say. You're very welcome this morning. And again, we're being led by our minister, Reverend Allen. And we look forward to what he has to say to us today. There's no announcements at the minute. I get away with it today. So you're very welcome anyway, and again, Alan will be with us next week and leading us again in praise and worship. Thank you.
Thank you, Dennis. Getting down to serious business. Are there any birthdays in the house? Anything to celebrate?
Okay. Thank you.
I know Elizabeth from working with her in Bangor, and I would usually call her the Doiler. So if you hear me saying the Doiler this, the Doiler that, that's who I'm talking about. Are there any other any birthdays in the house? Where's the, I saw some wee people about.
What do you say?
Oh, good choice, good choice. Any birthdays over this side of the house? I like to come down and see the whites of your eyes, just in case you're wondering. Okie dokie. One of the churches I had in Lisburn was MacRegall, and they near passed out the first Sunday I arrived because I was sitting at the back pew and I had a microphone. And they went, "You're not supposed to be here. You're supposed to be at the front of the church." And these guys over here think, have thought I've forgot about you. Anything to celebrate over here? Oh. It's worth coming to church just for the Haribos. Any Donegadeans?
Yes.
Two.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I know this place. I lived there for 7 years. On a bit of a serious note, I want to start the service. There's two wee passages of scripture I'm talking about today. First one's from Joshua, and the second one's from the book of James. And in Joshua, Joshua tells the people to consecrate themselves. Get yourself right with God, because tomorrow God's going to do amazing things. This is just before they crossed, went across the Jordan River. And then in James chapter 4, it says, "Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you." It's a command, and it's also a promise. We have to do our part, and God will do his part. And I'm going to hand this over to Rosemary, who's going to lead us in our... We're going to sing two pieces back to back, and the first one is Blessed Assurance.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. And we thank you for all the different seasons, for the rain, for the sun, for the wind, and for warmth and cold, and everything else that you provide for us. Father, we thank you for the gift of life, and more so, we thank you for the gift of eternal life. We thank you for our families, our friends, for the fellowship here in Glenburn, and all of our wider family connections. But Lord, we thank you for the relationship that we can have with you right now in this place. We thank you for the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. And we thank you again for the gift of eternal life. We thank you for being able to communicate with you at any time and any place. And we thank you for being faithful, where you listen to us, you speak to us. And Lord, we have to play our part and be obedient to your word. Lord, help us to be good and righteous servants in this place. But Father, we're human. We know that we get it wrong. We say things that we shouldn't. We do things that we shouldn't. And Lord, you allow us to come into your presence and confess all of our wrongdoing, all of the sins that we know about, all of those wee habits that we do habitually without even knowing about it. Lord, we lay down all of our sin in the silence of this prayer. Father God, you know each and every one of us that are gathered here this morning. You know what makes us tick, and you delight whenever we come before you and confess and acknowledge our wrongdoing and our sin. And Lord, we can come to you with a boldness in our hearts because your word tells us that we can. And when we confess our sins, you hear us, you forgive us, and you keep no record of our sin. Lord, let us be aware of your presence here this morning. Let us leave this place knowing that we have done business with the risen Lord. For we ask it in Jesus' name, who taught us to say as a family, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. There's two boyos out in the hall there that think they're getting away with. Just sitting out there letting on to be doing nothing. I have a wee job for you. Dennis and David, can I ask you to come in for a wee moment? Throughout the time that I'm going to be here in Glenburn, you're going to hear me talking about God's love quite a lot, or occasionally. And Dennis, I wonder could you go over that side and hand out those wee red hearts? David, could you do the same on that side?
Just chuckle.
And yep. And I'll do the middle here.
Thank you.
These wee red hearts, there's nothing magical about them. There's nothing special. And what I'm just going to say to you is put it in your purse, put it in your wallet, and just forget about it.
Thank you.
I better give you all three here in case I trip over this. Thank you. purse, put it in your wallet. Has everybody got one? Okay. You got one yourself, Dennis?
Yep.
Okie doke. There's nothing magical, nothing special. Just put it in your purse, just forget about it. What I ask you to do, you probably know this wee passage of Scripture, John chapter 3, verse 16. You probably quote it to me. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. You will hear me talking about God's love quite a lot from this pulpit, down the front of the church or down the back of the church, because God has done amazing things in my life. So put that in your pocket, your purse, or your handbag, or whatever. I brought some items with me. We talk about God's love, and we say, how do you measure God's love? So I have brought some items with me, just to see if we could measure God's love. Don't be telling Ruth, but I borrowed this morning. She doesn't know it's here. But if she watches this service later on, she'll be going, what are you doing with my lovely Pyrex dish? If you see some guy up here next week with sticking plasters, that would be me. So, can we measure God's love using one of these boils here? And to be honest, I don't think Pyrex make a bowl big enough that could measure God's love. And here's the wee passage of Scripture that I'm standing over. There's no cup big enough. Psalm 23, verse 5. It's up on the screen. My cup overflows. There's no cup big enough that we can measure God's love. You might say, God doesn't love me anymore. He doesn't love you any less. You can't measure God's love. There's no cup big enough in this world to measure God's love. I try to do a bit of DIY in the house. This is my boil here. You can either be feet and inches, or you can be a metric person. And if you wanted to measure, this is 12 feet, by the way. If you wanted to measure God's love with a tape measure, there wouldn't be a tape measure big enough to measure God's love either. There's another wee passage of Scripture. God's love is higher than the heavens. Up until yesterday, I was told, scientists told us, that the most furthest star ever detected was 13.7 billion light years away. And because of the James Webb Space Telescope, they've discovered another star 26 billion light years away. This is a wee bit of science here. This is where we get baffled about a light year. What's a light year in our speak? If we were to travel one light year using the technology that we have in this world today, it would take us, I think, 37,000 or 39,000 of our years to travel one light year. And if you measure about, think about God's love, there's no measuring tape big enough to measure God's love for all of us. This is my wee watch. Because I'm a military folk, I shouldn't be saying that, military person, I shouldn't be saying this on the internet. I work by 24-hour clock, and I'm still working 20, at 7 o'clock, it's 1900 hours. That's just the way my mind's wired. But I got myself this wee watch. It's a clock, but like you're looking up on the screen. And the only problem with it is, at night time you can't see it. See, my wee all singing, all dancing, I press this button and it lights up at night. And I go, it's 2300 hours. It's 23:59, that's 1 minute and midnight. There's not a clock big enough to measure God's love. Not one bit. It's up on the screen, from everlasting to everlasting. The Lord's love is with those who fear him. God loves us to bits, big and small, young and old. Doesn't matter what color you are, what creed you are. God loves each and every one of us. And the challenge for all of us, the challenge for me back in 1991, I read the Bible in secret for 4 months, and I come to the conclusion that the Bible was either the biggest load of balderdash ever written, or it was absolutely true. And the challenge for me that particular Sunday in 1991 was, if it's true, what are you going to do about it? God's love is real. And sometimes we have to take a wee step of faith and accept God's love in our life. Now, I got a wee bit confused earlier. We're going to sing a song, and there's actions to this song. Now, I don't think we have the words, but I don't think we need the words. If you go back to your Sunday school days, there was a wee song, "Wide, wide is the ocean, high as the heavens above." Oh, you know it. If I go down, I'll not be able to get up again. It's my Saviour's love. We all know it. Should we stand up and have a go at it? We're going to sing it twice, okay? Would you get it? A bit of exercise and a wee bit of fun at the same time, and praising God. Your offering for the work of the Lord will now be received. Loving Heavenly Father, please accept these gifts as a token of our love and use them here in the extension of your kingdom. Amen. Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, in our prayers for others this morning, we would like to lift up people that we know sitting in this congregation. People that are struggling physically, mentally, emotionally, in any way that they can be struggling. Lord, you know us from head to toe. You know how we are wired. You know all the pains and illnesses that we have. And Father, we present them all to you this day. And Lord, we ask for your healing upon our bodies, upon our soul, and upon our spirit. Lord, draw us close into you here this morning. And Lord, we pray for our families, for the white sheep in our families, and the black sheep as well. And we would ask that you would just reveal yourself to them. And Lord, we ask those, we present those people who are struggling financially in this world of we're still recovering from COVID and interest rates are going up and inflation is going up. And there may be people in our church that are struggling just to put a loaf of bread on the table. Father, we would ask that we could help practically in some way to ease their burden and to reveal you to them during their situation. And Lord, we pray for ourselves here this morning. Everyone gathered in this church and everyone who is watching this service online, we would pray a blessing on each and every one of us. We pray for your divine favor just to rest and settle on us, to open our hearts, to open our minds, and for you to reveal your love to us. And Father, we pray for all those unspoken prayers that are being mentioned right now. We lift each and every one of them up to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. I have two passages of scripture that I would like to read. The first one is Joshua chapter 3. And then if you could flick over and keep your finger on James chapter 4. So I'm reading from Joshua chapter 3 and verses 1 to 8. It's entitled in my Bible, Crossing the Jordan. And it says, early in the morning, Joshua and all the Israelites set out from Shittim and went to the Jordan, where they camped before crossing over. After 3 days, the officers went throughout the camp, giving orders to the people. When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, and the Levitical priests carrying it, you are to move out from your positions and follow it. Then you will know which way to go, since you have never been this way before. But keep a distance of about 2,000 cubits between you and the ark. Do not go near it. Joshua told the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things. Joshua said to the priests, take up the Ark of the Covenant and pass on ahead of the people. So they took it up and went ahead of them. And the Lord said to Joshua, today I will begin to exalt you in the eyes of all Israel, so that they may know that I am with you, as I was with Moses. Tell the priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant, when you reach the edge of the Jordan's river, go and stand in the river. And now I'm going to jump on to James chapter 4. Reading from verse 1. It's entitled, Submit Yourselves to God. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire, but you do not have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with the wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell in us? But he gives us more grace. This is why Scripture says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter into mourning, and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Amen. Here's the story so far in Joshua chapter 3. Because of the Israelites' unbelief, they have been wandering in the desert for 40 years. 1 year for each of the days that the spies were exploring the promised land. Moses has died, and Joshua has been commissioned as the leader to lead the children of God, the Israelites, into the promised land. So that brings us to the beginning of Joshua chapter 3. And compared to the previous chapters, this chapter is actually quite short. And in the grand scheme of things, it doesn't really cover a lot of ground. Time-wise, it covers a period of 3 days as they prepare to cross the Jordan River. Distance-wise, it's a couple of miles from this town called Shittim to the Jordan River itself. And event-wise, Joshua chapter 3 is about the children of Israel crossing the River Jordan into the Promised Land. So we have to take note of, this is a wee important bit, there's no army chasing the children of Israel. And there's no army on the other side of the Jordan River waiting on the children of Israel until they cross. And the Jordan River, we see pictures of the Jordan River today from Israel, and it looks like a wee gentle, oh, I'd love to waddle my wee feet in that wee river. It looks very gentle and calm and peaceful. But the Bible says, if you read on that wee passage of Joshua chapter 3, it tells us that the Jordan River was flooded because it was harvest season. Now, when we say it was flooded, what does that mean? Was it just a couple of feet higher than normal? Well, when they say flooded, they could be meaning this. If you're into whitewater canoeing, you know those canoes where they wear life jackets and helmets, and the waves are about 6 to 8 feet, and these guys are lunatics who go down this river and think it's fun. That's the state that the Jordan River was in. That is the river that the Israelites had to cross over. I'm going to read the first couple of verses again. It says, Joshua rose early in the morning and set out from Shittim, and he came to the River Jordan. And the children of Israel, the nation of Israel, camped beside the Jordan River. After 3 days, the officers went throughout the camp, giving specific orders to the people. And this is what the orders were. When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the Levitical priests carrying it, you are to move from your positions and follow it. Then you will know which way to go, since you have never been this way before. But keep a distance of 2,000 cubits between you and the ark, and do not go near it. And then Joshua said to the people, this is a wee bit that interests us, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord is going to do amazing things. Back in the day, the Israelites consecrated themselves ceremonially by washing themselves and washing their clothes. They abstained from sexual relationships. That's Exodus chapter 19. But there's a wee interesting story. In the book of 1 Chronicles chapter 13, David, the Ark of the Covenant wasn't where it was supposed to be, and King David wanted the Ark brought back to Jerusalem. So this is what he did. You can read about this. 1 Chronicles chapter 13. They moved the Ark of the Covenant from this town to Jerusalem. And there was two men there, Uzzah and Ahio. And they were there to guide the Ark of the horse, the oxen, the cart, and the Ark of the Covenant back to its journey to Jerusalem. But one of the ox stumbled a wee bit. And the guy called Uzzah reached out to prevent the ark, I dare say to prevent the ark from falling off the cart. And God struck him down dead, just like that there, because he put his hand on the Ark of the Covenant. Our God is a God of order. And sometimes we read things in the Bible and it just passes over us. That wee bit where it says, whenever you see the Ark of the Covenant being carried by the priests, get up from your positions and follow it, but keep a distance of about 2,000 cubits between you and the Ark of the Covenant. Now, in our speak, that's a distance of about 3 football fields between us and the Ark of the Covenant. And each tribe, there was 12 tribes, so the 12 tribes, there was an order of march from the first to the last. They all had a certain position. It's a bit like the 12th of July parade. All the lodges meet up in Belfast. I don't know how to do it, but they're all in the order, the first lodge right down to the last lodge. This is what the Israelites had to do. 2,000 meters or 2,000 cubits, 3 football fields distance, and whatever tribe they were, they had to get an order with the order of march. Whenever you see that happen, before that happened, Joshua said, guys, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord is going to do amazing things. He didn't tell them to sharpen your knives, sharpen your swords, go out and polish your shields. He didn't tell them to go out and build new churches or get all religious on them. The message was, consecrate yourselves. It's a command and it's a promise as well. The word consecrate, we don't use it that much nowadays. You might hear it in church, that word consecrate. It means the separation of oneself from things that are unclean, especially something that would contaminate your relationship with a perfect God. Consecrate yourself. Get yourself right with God. Stop doing what you shouldn't be doing and get yourself right with God. The command, consecrate themselves, was to remind them that he was their God and that they were his people. The first 5 books of the Bible gave the people instructions of how God wanted them to think, how to live, and how to live out, act out their lives where they were. God wanted his people to be set apart and to live differently from the world in which they lived. In today's language, we hear the words in James, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. In Joshua chapter 3, Joshua gave the people a command that probably meant this. Guys, you've got tonight to think about yourself and how you relate to God. Go back to your tribes, your clans, and your families and prepare yourselves because God's going to do amazing things tomorrow. For us, consecrating ourselves is a bit like taking the time out to be still, to hear what God has to say to us. It's about being still, reminding ourselves that God is still God and we are his people. And one of the things that we have to do, this is the wee hard bit that we find, it's the wee bit about being obedient. That's the bit that we struggle. Oh no, God didn't really know what he was talking about. I'm not doing that, Lord. That's too hard. I don't have the resources, the skills, or the energy. It's the obedient bit that we struggle with. When Ruth was the minister of Donaghadee, and it was my last service in Donaghadee, as a civilian, if you like, before I went into Edge Hill College to start training for the ministry. It was the Reverend Winston Graham. The church had prayed for me. Winston Graham stood up and he pointed at me. He says, Alan, we are not called to do great things. It's him who does the great things. We are called to be obedient. And I actually have those words in my preaching folder today to remind me we're not called to do great things. We are called to be obedient. Going back to the people in Joshua chapter 3, the ball was in their court, so to speak. They could either obey God and consecrate themselves, get themselves right with God, or they could disobey. God was going to do amazing things with them, among them tomorrow. God wants to do amazing things with us here in Glenburn Methodist Church. He wants to reveal himself to each and every one of us. He wants to bless us. The Israelites, needed to consecrate themselves before they could move forward. They needed to get themselves right with God before they crossed over into the promised land. But those guys back in Joshua chapter 3, those guys back in the Old Testament, had something tangible that they could actually see. They could see the Ark of the Covenant. They could see the priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant. On the 16th of July, 2023, it's a wee bit different for us. We are called to walk by faith and not by sight. We can all get religious and serve God in our own way. It's a wee bit like that guy. Uzzah probably had the best intentions to put his hand out to stop the Ark of the Covenant falling off that cart, but it wasn't God's way of doing business. We might have the right intentions, but they may not be God's way of doing business. We have a choice. We can choose to obey and be guided by God. We could walk in the adventure of being called a Christian instead of having a good grief. Is this what you call living the victorious life? I'm bored out of my brains here. We're doing nothing. We're just doing the same thing week after week after week. But what if we, as a church, as individuals and as a church, we started being still and started listening to God? And maybe God might say the same thing to all of us at the same time. And this is the wee hard bit. It's the being obedient. So how do we consecrate ourselves? How do we draw near to God? Matthew chapter 6, verse 6 gives us a wee clue. Go into your room, close the door, and pray. You could maybe pray a prayer like King David did in Psalm 51. He said, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all the iniquity and cleanse me from my sin." King David was no angel. Drawing near to God involves surrendering. Surrendering ourselves, surrendering our pride, surrendering our sin and following God. Someone has once said, "A 1,000-mile journey begins with the first step." If we never take that first step, we will never finish the journey that we're going to embark on. And whenever we talk about drawing near to God, sometimes we get grand ideas about it. We talk about it, plan it, write books about it, and sometimes we never actually start that journey. That's the invitation that everyone in this church, for everyone in this church, and I would like you to join me in participating in that journey. I would love to walk with you along this journey and see God do amazing things in this place, in this community. I'm not interested in flag waving. I'm not interested in being called the me monster. If I get so, my head gets so puffed up, you might need a double set of doors to get my big head out through there. I just want to follow God faithfully and passionately. And I know that there's some people in this church would like to do that as well. There are many people in this church here this morning and people watching on the internet that are ready to draw near to God because you have prepared yourselves, you have prepared your heart to draw near to God. We're not called to do great things. We're just called to be obedient. And I'm going to finish in the words in the psalmist, Psalm 139, in the words of the Message version of the Bible. I'm going to say it as a wee closing prayer for all of us. Let us make this prayer as individuals, and let us make this prayer as a church. So let us pray.
Amen.
Loving Heavenly Father, investigate our lives. Find out everything about us. Cross-examine us and test us. Get a clear picture of what we are about, Lord. See for yourself whether we have done anything wrong. and guide us on the road to eternal life. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn is a wee Robin Mark number. I'm a Robin Mark groupie. And I love his songs, and his songs just speak into your soul. And this is us, as the deer pants for the water. Can we share the grace with each other? May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.